So is this foundation made up of concrete?
Oh.
Of the from the building on the side of the block. And make sure you don't confuse when you see IBD versus IBS. IBD not about this. IBS is what? It's about center. IBS, you have information. That's the country. Okay. So you should be able to differentiate if you go on exploratory findings between a butterfly and a swarm. Typically, most of the findings will be similar. Differences that you can see in the condition and how they present. Also discuss the assessment, non-drift colliding vessels, from the beach. All diseases have complications, so we need to be aware of the potential complications we can have. I will also need to understand the mechanism of action of the medication to use to manage this condition. Again, both conditions will manage the same type of medication. Discuss the role of immunomodulators, like the diaphragm and the Brexit. Discuss the role of hemolytic response modifiers, or you may just see biologics. The biologics usually will be the mainstay in the management of the primary bowel disease. It may not be the initial class of drug you use, but they are the mainstay in treating the disease. Discuss the role of antibiotics. A lot of times you may also see patients who, in addition to the inflammation, they may also have an infection. Typically, we talk about antibiotics, we're looking at quinolones, drugs like metronidazole. For example, the ciprofloxacin and metronidazole, these are the typical antibiotics we're looking for. Should be able to write a soap note based on a case presentation. So let's look at a case. Chief complaint, I can't take the pain and diarrhea anymore. I thought I could make it until I got on the treatment after, but today I realized I needed to see someone. History of brain illness. This is a 33-year-old woman who presents to the ED. The chief complaint of 1.5 weeks history of abdominal pain associated with cramping or diarrhea. So the diarrhea will be one of the symptoms patient will present with. The abdominal pain is associated with cramping, and in addition to diarrhea, the patient also has some mucus. She says it's typical of ulcerative colitis flares. So the disease can be controlled. All of a sudden, the patient may have a flare. So the disease can be controlled, and all of a sudden, the patient may have a flare. So we also need to know how to manage that. She says that she has been having about 4 to 5 bloody bowel movements a day. Also, the number of bowel movements they have a day can also be used to characterize the severity of the disease. The patient has 2 bowel movements a day, that will be less severe than the patient who has 4 to 5 bowel movements a day. In the prominent stage, the patient may even have 10 bowel movements a day. So the number of bowel movements they have daily, that can be used to determine the severity of the symptoms. easy when she stood up. She don't have any symptoms while sitting or lying down. She has been here on vacation for almost 2 weeks and is scheduled to return home in 3 days. She has not traveled outside the country. Again, you want to differentiate if this is travel outside already, because I'm starting. She's not been hospitalized and has not received antibiotics. Again, some antibiotics can also reduce the risk of diarrhea in patients. So you want that history to make sure patient has not been exposed to antibiotics. She was diagnosed with UC approximately 3 years ago and has approximately one exacerbation a year that our physician has treated with Pentosa. Pentosa is a brand name for aminosalicylate. They have the specific product she's been using. She takes it 4 times a day, which for this patient may be a problem in terms of adherence. They have to take it 4 times a day, and some patients may not be able to tolerate that. So, as a pharmacist, we have the concern for the patient, they want to find a clinic. They want to find medication that you will take twice a day or once a day. That will help with the adherence. Each time her symptoms have resolved with 4 to 6 weeks of therapy, she has reduced maintenance therapy because she does not want to take medication 4 times. Again, so we have options. Instead of 4 times a day, we have medication the patient can take once a day or twice a day. It is not conducive to the for her work and social life, and she has refused rectal medications for the same reason. Her last exacerbation was 10 months ago. Her past medical history, also with colitis, diagnosed 3 years ago. She has type 1 diabetes and insulin. And these are the medications. No issue of vaccination. Again, this patient, because they are immunocompromised, they also need to have stopped their regular vaccination. No known drug allergies. Family history, mother has history of CAD, lung cancer, father has a history of ulcerative colitis. So ulcerative colitis can run in families. Status quo colectomy 18 years ago. Social history, works as an office manager, lives with a fiancé, no children, denies tobacco use. Now, tobacco use can also help some patients. It's not recommended, but it can also help some patients who have ulcerative colitis. Patients who have ulcerative colitis tend to have less flare than they smoke, or they wouldn't smoke. Again, like I said, it's not recommended for patients to be smoking. But occasionally, you may see patients getting nicotine patch for this condition. Okay, she drinks 1 or 2 glasses of wine every few weeks. Acknowledges marijuana use in the 90s, or stage 1 in the past 10 years. This like the nervous system, negative of chest pain, shortness of breath, dysuria, fever, chills, nausea, vomiting, malaria, gastritis. So the review system is basically unremarkable except for the abdominal soreness. Physical exam, general, this is pleasant, healthy, appearing Caucasian woman in no acute distress. The vital signs, look at the blood pressure, lying down 100 for 2 weeks with a pulse of 60. When I'm standing, blood pressure is 40, ischemia of 40, and a pulse of 75. So what's happening with the blood pressure?
It's dropping.
Yeah, I can see it's dropping, but what would be our assessment?
Well, starting off.
What? Orthostatic hypertension. Orthostatic hypotension. What is the most common cause of orthostatic hypertension? in-laws, brother-in-laws, cousin-in-law, come on board. When patient had this condition, this day you have to be clear your body. So what place a patient like this at risk for brother-in-laws?
Loss of blood.
Number of diarrhea. It's not been high diarrhea. That place, they're losing blood and diarrhea. Electrolyte wise, that will also affect potassium. That will also affect potassium. The patient's weight is 66 kg. The usual weight is 68, so the patient has lost some weight. AT&T remarkable, lung exam remarkable, cardiovascular exam also remarkable. So we also need to focus on the abdomen. The abdominal exam, the patient has normal active bowel sounds. But the abdomen is non-distended, distended to deep palpation. But no palpable mass. No liver skin enlargement. No rebound tenderness or clarity. Rectal exam, somewhat tender. Again, we expect that because the patient has been having a lot of diarrhea. No hemorrhoids, no fissures or lesions. Okay, this is important. Suspect a patient has inflammatory bowel disease. The absence of fissure or lesion can differentiate Crohn's disease from ulcerative colitis. So typically you don't see fissures or lesion in ulcerative colitis, you see it in Crohn's disease. Okay. The patient is the stool is skin positive. Musculoskeletal extremities, no clubbing, sinuses, edema, forces to close, normal range of motion, strength bilaterally, 5/5, which is normal. Neurologic exam, alert and oriented, x-ray. Cranial nerves, through the 12 intact. And deep tendon reflexes are too close, which is normal. And these are the labs. So even though this patient is truly skin positive, the patient has not developed anemia yet. A lot of this patient, based on the severity of the disease, they can develop anemia. But you see, most of them is 13. Also, the potassium is below the lower limit of normal.
Just like.
Albumin, that's something you also need to look at. A lot of these patients are often malnourished, but this indicates that this patient has good nourishment. The WBC is within normal range.
The BUN is 26.
Yeah, the BUN is 26, that is abnormal. Again, that is consistent with what we just discussed. Dehydration. But once she starts receiving the volume, the urine should be coming down. Okay. So, the clinical course for this patient, the patient was given 1 liter of normal saline and 40 mEq of potassium. So again, just to reemphasize, why is this patient getting 1 liter of normal saline?
Yeah, because of to replenish.
The patient has autostatic hypotension. Patient has autostatic hypotension and saline. The most common reason why patients would have that is because of
volume loss.
Volume loss. study lab, the patient's potassium was what?
3.4.
Okay, so that's why the patient is getting potassium. So why is this potassium being given over 4 hours?
Okay.
Who else? She says something. I want to see if someone can also say the same thing.
If she says IV, intermittent IV,
can I repeat the question?
Because they give 10 million equivalents every hour.
Okay, so I've heard it from two people. You don't. Peripherally, you don't give it more than 10 mg/hour. Centrally, yes, you can, but usually it will be
stuck.
The unit you get can be monitored. But peripherally, it has to be 10 mg/hour or less per hour. So this patient is getting 40 over 4 hours. So that's why the patient is getting over 4 hours, because of it. You have to go into your 40. Okay. So the patient received 1 liter, and the vital signs at 3 p.m. as follows. BP lying down is 110. BP standing, so the patient has recovered. Blood pressure has recovered. Okay. And the labs repeated, so the K has also increased, and the BUN has also dropped. Okay. So when we talk about inflammatory bowel disease, with ulcerative colitis, it's going to affect just mainly the colon, whereas Crohn's disease will affect the entire GI. Ulcerative colitis is going to affect the colon. Crohn's disease will affect the entire GI, from the all the way from the mouth to the anal region. And when we look at the the colon, we have left side, we have right side, and we have the transverse. So depending on where the location that is affected, that will also determine what type of treatment this patient is going to get. At this splenic flexure, that's a demarcation point where you can get a rectal preparation. So if it happens, the patient have left-sided colitis, this patient can get rectal preparation. But again, if it goes beyond the sigmoid colon, then again you have to narrow which type of rectal preparation you can get. Typically, in the rectal area, you can get suppository. If it extends beyond that, then you can get any. If it extends beyond the splenic flexure, for the rectal progression, we know that we not get there. So this patient will need some oral preparation initially. Typically, if they don't respond to the oral preparation, then you can escalate the type of treatment you want to give. So when we say left-sided colitis, basically this is where we're referring. So the patient can have left-sided colitis. The patient who has ulcerative colitis, it almost always starts from the right. Ulcerative colitis almost always starts from the rectum.
And where?
Rectal
region. In ulcerative colitis, almost always starts from the rectum. Whereas in Crohn's disease, the sacroiliac junction is almost always involved. The sacral, where the small intestine meets the large intestine. So almost always involved in Crohn's disease. same thing with crystals. And strictures, you also see strictures in a Crohn's disease. In Crohn's disease, when we say the mucosa is involved, typically in ulcerative colitis, it's going to just be the topical mucosa. Whereas in Crohn's disease, it's going to penetrate the mucosa. It's going to penetrate the mucosa. So that's why these people, at this patient, they also have strictures. And that can cause narrowing. Cause important complications. But you don't see fissures, strictures, fistulas in ulcerative colitis. You see them in Crohn's disease. Toxic megacolon, that's a complication you can also see because of the dilation of the affected segment. And that can be an emergency because it can rupture. A lot of these patients, when they have diarrhea, they may also take over-the-counter preparation that contains an anticholinergic. So that will be contraindicated if you want to start with menopause. Anticholinergic will be contraindicated. Okay. Okay, so basically I just talked about toxic menopause. So patient may have a toxic presentation when they have tachycardia, increase in temperature, leukocytosis, and the albumin is low. So typically, the treatment of patients like this would be parenteral preparation, parenteral corticosteroids, antibiotics. That's how you manage the acute phase of this condition. What we describe the involvement of ulcerative colitis, you can say it's proctitis, basically when it just affects the rectum. Proctosigmoiditis, you know, involve the rectum and the sigmoid area. We already talked about left-sided colitis. Extensive disease usually will begin when it goes beyond the splenic flexure. It goes beyond the splenic flexure, that will be an extensive disease. But it does not get to the cecum. The entire colon is involved. That's the pancolitis. The entire colon is involved. That will be pancolitis. So the typical presentation that we saw in a patient would be diarrhea associated with some blood. The patient would have some rectal bleeding, abdominal pain and cramping. Like I discussed previously, a lot of this patient would also have malnutrition. And you can see that from the albumin. Weight loss, a patient 6 kg, patient usually was 68. We see these patients present with diarrhea, but however, if the patient has involvement of bronchitis, they may sometimes have constipation. So that's the only time you see constipation in this patient, if it involves bronchitis. So fever, dehydration, again, you may have extra intestinal manifestation like arthritis, you may have some extra intestinal manifestation like arthritis, hemorrhoids, you may see occasionally in ulcerative colitis, and you may also see the rectal abscess. Again, we talked about fissure and fistula and Crohn's disease. Now, some patients may have this morphonal diarrhea, and that can be used to differentiate between Crohn's versus ulcerative. the laboratory test, this will be the blood sample. Patient will have leukocytosis, not always, but in severe disease, you're going to see leukocytosis. In severe disease, moderate to severe disease, you're going to see decrease in hemoglobin. In our patient, hemoglobin was still okay. But as the disease progresses, you will see a decline in the hemoglobin. And as you see that, you will also see an increase in erythrocyte sedimentation rate of C-reactive protein. In the management of inflammatory bowel disease, one of the markers you use will be C-reactive protein. Typically, we don't use the erythrocyte sedimentation rate. We use C-reactive protein as the serological marker. We can also use another marker, which would be fecal matter. We will use fecal calprotectin. That will be from the stool. CRP will be from the blood. Fecal calprotectin will be from the stool. So those are the two basic biomarkers you can use to monitor the disease. Okay. Otherwise, patient will have to go some sidewalk endoscopy, colonoscopy. So to avoid that, we use CRP and fecal calprotectin in our patients. So we talked about severity of the disease, a number of stools per day. If it's less than 4, it's mild. If it's between 4 but less than 6, that will be moderate. If it's between 4 but less than 6, that will be moderate. If it's greater than 6, that will be severe. 10 or more will be prominent. So we can use the number of stools per day to determine the severity of the disease. And these are some condition that main thing, just the number of stools we have per day. Now, we need to be clear that the symptoms alone do not tell how well the patient is doing. For you to determine how well the patient is doing, you all need to look at the mucosa. For some patients may not be symptomatic, even though they have mucosa changes. So, but however, instead of doing colonoscopy, fecal calprotectin or CRP be a surrogate marker in terms of how the patient is doing. For example, you may give them, the patient may be getting their medication, and the number of stools may decrease. But that does not indicate that the inflammatory changes have improved. So to tell that the inflammatory changes have improved, you should be following the CRP or fecal calprotectin. Concentration should be decreased. Concentration of the CRP or the fecal calprotectin should be decreased. That will tell you that yes, this patient condition is improving. So in terms of diagnosis, the gold standard is going to be colonoscopy, but it is invasive. So in lieu of doing that, you can use the fecal biomarkers, and you can also use C-reactive protein. Now the C-reactive protein is not as good as the fecal biomarker because the inflammatory process can increase. Any inflammatory process can increase the C-reactive protein. Whereas the fecal calprotectin, they are produced by the inflammatory cells. They That's why this is preferred over Syria. Again, this will be considered non-invasive. All of them will be considered non-invasive. So in terms of these two biomarkers, why do you think fecal calf protection is considered a gold standard? Okay, I just mentioned a while ago that any inflammatory process can increase the serial difference. However, the fecal calf protection
inflammatory cells themselves, yes.
So that's why this is the gold standard. So a lot of this patient may also have vitamin deficiencies because malabsorption. Remember I mentioned a lot of them may have malnutrition, but they also have vitamins. I talked about nutrition a while ago. Ulcerative colitis, but not in Crohn's disease, because smoking can exacerbate Crohn's disease. And in terms of management, the goal is to induce remission. Of course, we don't have a cure for this disease. So patients will also need maintenance therapy. But the goal is to induce remission. So we have corticosteroids, 5-ASA, immunomodulators, antibiotics, biologics. Typically, the aminosalicylate has been the primary initial class of drugs to use. The 5-ASA preparation, mesalamine. If patients are not responding, they can progress. Now remember, immunomodulators, biologic, are much more toxic agents. They're very effective, but also very toxic. So we try to start with 5-ASA and see how the patient responds. And we can escalate the therapy if we don't get adequate response. So these are the class of medications, corticosteroid, 5-ASA, immunomodulators, and biologics. Now the corticosteroid usually is indicated for acute situations. Not indicated for long-term maintenance because of the complications involved in the use. There's going to be short-term use of corticosteroids. That statement I just made is true for all the corticosteroids except budesonide. Budesonide is not considered to be a systemic corticosteroid because it has high pass, best pass methodology. So it's merely considered a topical agent, unlike the other corticosteroids. So when we say it's not indicated for long term use, that is true for all corticosteroids except for this one. This is just an algorithm that we can use in terms of managing the disease. they and if the patient has severe disease, they will be on IV corticosteroids. Again, like I mentioned, it's going to be for short term and acute exacerbation. So you want to transition the patient off the corticosteroids. Again, the corticosteroids are not indicated for maintenance except reducing it. So the goal, if the patient is on corticosteroids, the goal is to taper them off the corticosteroids. And that will bring us to the next slide. So, the disease is steroid responsive. If you try them on prednisone 40 to 60 milligrams per day or equivalent, they should respond within 30 days if you give it IV within 7 or 10 days. That would be considered steroid responsive. Their symptoms should be improving. You have what they also call steroid-dependent disease. The same thing, you give them the same amount of corticosteroid, and you try to taper it off, patient will have a relapse. So in the past, what has been done, when you go to the last dose that but again, we say we don't want patients to be on long-term corticosteroids. So do that if the patients are steroid dependent, we want to transition them off that steroid. We want to use drugs like immunomodulators that are corticosteroids there. But the disadvantage there is that the immunomodulators take a long time to work. So this patient is going to be both agents and immunomodulators start working like a virus, then you can start tapering the corticosteroid off. But the immunomodulators are corticosteroids fair. Okay. Then you have patients who you give corticosteroid, give them the same dose, they're not going to respond. So these are the patients that you can go directly to immunomodulators, or you can go straight to biologics. Currently, we now know that the recommendation now, when you give biologics, you want to combine it with immunomodulator. And there's a reason for that. In the past, we used to give biologics by themselves, but now we know that the current recommendation is to combine the biologics with immunomodulator. So these are the different types of corticosteroids available. Uceris MMX was specifically developed to be released at what part of the GI?
Right.
Where is small intestine means the large intestine? That's where the MMX is supposed to be located, specifically for that portion there. MMX, just the line. If the patient has left-sided or just rectal involvement, initially I say if it's just rectal involvement, it may need suppository. If it goes beyond the sigmoid, and even hemi. But you may also see patients getting both rectal preparation and oral preparation. So the combination is superior to the other. So you may see patients getting both oral and rectal preparation. That's because the combination is superior to the other. So these are the biologics. The first one that was used in this condition would be infliximab, is kind of the standard. And these are the oral preparations, oral formulations. The JAK inhibitors, these are the oral preparations. They also refer to as small molecules. They also refer to as small molecules. Interleukin inhibitor, secunumab and cetuximab, primarily they also affect interleukin 23, 12 or primary 23. Atezolizumab is still available, but it's not frequently used because of its unique association with the condition we'll refer to, we'll talk about later. And that's
which drug did you say?
Atezolizumab. These are the two integrin inhibitors, and atezolizumab was the first one, and it's associated with the condition we'll discuss later. So clinicians who need to prescribe this have to be registered for what is called a TORCH program. They have to be registered in that program to be able to prescribe medication. So this, atezolizumab came after that and it doesn't have that restriction. So you find that Tysabri is no use commonly. Okay. So when we use the biologics, the term we use in treatment is triptotide. That's the current recommendation from the American College of Gastroenterology. Triptotide. Remember, I said a while ago, when you treat a patient, their symptoms may be resolving, but that does not mean that disease condition is improving. So you're going to look at a combination of factors. So when we say treat to target, we're talking about looking for anti-drug antibodies and also measuring a trough blood level, measuring a blood trough level. So we have TDM now for the biologics. We have therapeutic drug monitoring now for the biologics. Last year, we did not include inflammatory bowel disease in 639. And I realized that American College of Gastroenterology is requiring TDM to be done. And that's what brought it back in this name. Okay, so you're aware that the biologics TDM is required. And we'll talk about that. Okay, so treat to target, you want to make sure you go beyond the symptom. That will also include looking at 49 fecal calprotectin. So you have to measure primarily fecal calprotectin. So if the patient disease is doing better, the concentration should be coming down. Not just the symptoms, number of diarrhea. That's why we say trick to targets. That means we also need to use a specific amount of the biologics that will give us a specific trough concentration. Most patients who don't have that subtherapeutic trough concentration, they don't do well, they have a relapse. So if you fall within that condition, then you are sure that this patient is going to do better. So we need to treat the target. Okay, make sure you remember RAN and generic names. Okay, so basically, in terms of the immune modulators, that would include the thyroprene, sigma-carbapenem, and the tetracycline. The problem with this is the thyroprene, sigma-carbapenem, it may take up to 3 to 6 months for patients to get good adequate response. Before you place the patient on these two medications, there's a lab test you need to do. We'll talk about that later. You have to do that lab test before you place the patient on this medication. Again, these are the two oral preparations that we have. A while ago I said these two preparations were small molecules. Another small molecule that we have that has been recently been included is to be ozanimod. Ozanimod is also a small molecule. So these three, the last three, they are all small molecules. So in terms of TDN, these are some blood levels associated with good therapeutic response. Currently, golimumab blood level, trough level has not been established. Again, we're looking at the trough level. Now, when we say trough level, the level that is drawn before the next level. Level that is drawn before the next step. So that's what we refer to as a trough level. So it's important that you do that if the patient is not responding. If you do a trough level and it exceeds this threshold, that means the patient is not responding. So the patient is going to need a different medication. In addition to the trough level, you also need to do anti-drug antibody to see if the antibody against that medication. If the patient develops antibody against that medication, then that will also make that medication to be ineffective. So not only are you doing the blood trough level, you're also doing the ADA. If the trough is subtherapeutic and the anti-drug antibodies are present, then we need to choose another biologic agent. We need to choose another biologic agent. Again, when we choose another biologic agent, we also need to make sure we add an immune modulator, like a thyroprene. patient has, anytime they have anti-drug antibodies, then we need to change to a different class. We need to change to a different class. Okay, so the reason we do the TDM is to optimize this medication.
You skip a slide.
Okay, I think I'll put it. I'll put it in your handout. Still, you go to your platform. Okay. But this is to optimize the therapeutic modality that you're using. We also have what is called reactive versus proactive TDM. Reactive versus proactive TDM. Reactive is like the worst case. Give this patient their medication and you don't get the response you expect. Then you do the TDM, you do the ADA. As a result of the patient not responding, that will be a reactive TDM. Now, if you're reacting to what is occurring, what is proactive, you do that right at the beginning. Before you give this medication, you check the ADA if any is present. Of course, you should not expect that to be present. But the proactive medication measures the drug concentration ADA. We do adaptation to target. So when you start a medication, if you're going to give it for 8 weeks, 6 weeks, you want to see if you if your target is reached in terms of the drug. You also want to see if you have any ADA or not. So at that point, you can make an adjustment. So you don't wait until the patient is not responding before you make the adjustment. So that will be this will be the proactive TDM. This can also help to facilitate what we call primary non-responders. About 30% of patients, when you give them biologic, they are not going to respond. So these are the primary non-responders. And you also have secondary loss of response. They responded initially, but subsequently they lost response. So we need to check why they're losing this response. So we need to do the drug and the ADA.
Drop down. Yeah, thank you.
It can cause blood flow, they can come and die with fracture. Again, this drug is not going to be a first line agent. You tend to use this drug if patients do not have adequate response to drugs like infliximab. So basically, you reserve for patients who do not tolerate or fail their TNF blockers. Again, they have increased risk of thrombosis. So you want to use the minimum effective dose. You want to use the minimum effective dose. So some of the cardiac events can be manifested as shortness of breath, chest pain, swelling of the leg and arm, leg pain. So you can make an adjustment. The patient initially was taking 10 milligrams. You can tell them omega twice a day can decrease that by 50%. But again, the small molecules are very toxic. So we want to make sure the patient are not respond to this, not responding to the standard biological flow we use this medication. It's very tempting to use this agent because they can give them oral. At the therapy range, they can be used to maintain remission. They are not used to induce remission. Why is that so? I mentioned it a while ago, but I did not specifically give a reason. So the therapy range is not used to induce remission. Used to maintain remission. Why is that so? Exactly. The onset of action, within over 3 months. So it's useless in remission, inducing remission. But it can be used to maintain remission. But that is maybe you can combine this with the biologic. Combined with the biologic is to decrease antibody production to the biologics. By combining this with the biologic, you decrease the risk of the patient develop antibodies to the biologic agent, which will enhance the effect of the biologic. Remember I said, before you give the therapy range, you have to do a blood test. You have to do the therapy range material transfer test before you place the patient on the therapy range 6-methoxypyridine. You want to see the activity of the enzyme. If the enzyme has low activity, then you don't want to use it. That means the drug is going to be metabolized very slowly. These drugs are very toxic. They can cause myelosuppression. So if the enzyme is not activity is low, you want to avoid it. On the other extreme, if the enzyme activity is very high, then you may need to adjust the dose of the medication. So that means the clearance will increase. At low activity, the clearance is low. High activity, the clearance is high. So if the clearance is high, then you want to adjust the dose of UTAD. You actually increase the dose of the medication. But definitely, we need to know the level of the therapeutic medic transfer before you start this mechanical period in this attack. Okay, so these are some of the 5-ASA preparations, mesalamine preparations. So in our patient, the patient was getting the pentasa, which she was getting 4 times a day. So we have preparations that can be given daily. We have the elder Briso. So this is a choice for the patient. Now the basalazide, this particular brand, Yazo, is primary indication for male patients. Diphenton, which can also be given twice daily. In clinicians don't use that much because it can also cause diarrhea. It's available. Initially, clinicians were using it, but found out it causes a lot of diarrhea. Initially, initially you thought the disease was actually progressive. So it's falling out of favor, but it's still available. So it's like the patient who doesn't want to take medication four times a day, so we have our time. So we have active tolerance, intolerance syndrome. The patient is mesalamine. They may have cramping, abdominal pain, bloody diarrhea, fever, headache, malaise, rash. We also need to monitor the renal function when you give them mesalamine. We also need to monitor renal function when you give them mesalamine. Now, this actually should be sulfosalazine, and this should be SULF, that should be F, not sulfosalazine, it should be sulfosalazine. So sulfosalazine, what do you have in sulfosalazine? This is the first 5 ASA preparation. This is the first 5 ASA preparation. So what makes up of the
salad? A few.
Sulfosalazine contains 5-ASA, mesalamine, and sulfapyridine. Sulfapyridine. Sulfosalazine contains sulfapyridine and 5-ASA, and it's the 5-ASA that is the active moiety. So if you give a patient sulfosalazine, most of the adverse effects you get will be from this sulfapyridine. Most of the adverse effects you will be from the sulfapyridine. The sulfapyridine component is broken down. The azoreductase will break down that bond and it passes the stomach. If the azo bond is broken in the stomach, then the 5-ASA cannot get to the intestine. Once it passes the stomach, already it increases. So the azoreductase bond will be broken to release the 5-ASA, which is the active compound. Then this is absorbed, causing most of the other. So it is the 5-ASA now that is having a lot of preparations that we set out. The 5-ASA, the oral 5-ASA preparation, they also have some enteric coating to bypass releasing the stomach. They also have bypass. They have coating to bypass releasing the stomach. Because you Asia may also be a public acid, one milligram daily. Because the sulfapyridine can cause folate deficiency. Sulfapyridine can cause folate deficiency. It makes your patient get folic acid once, yes. So if we have a patient who has severe disease, like I mentioned previously, you want to give them parenteral corticosteroid, hydrocortisone, metoprednisolone, or equivalent. And you can also start the induction dose. Again, when the patient is started on hydrocorticosteroid, usually you're going to start them with parenteral preparation, which can be given for three to 4 or 5 days. After that, you can switch to oral corticosteroid for up to 10 days. The reason you don't want to stay on corticosteroid chronically is because of the metabolic effect. And you can also suppress the immune response. Vedolizumab, again, will be indicated in moderate to severe active ulcerative colitis in patients that do not respond to infliximab, or they cannot follow it infliximab, or they've lost response to infliximab. You can also use it in patients that are steroid dependent. About it initially. So this can be given concurrently with immunomodulators like the diaphragm. Again, you also see probiotics being used to receive the GI in terms of patients having diarrhea. Now, with vedolizumab, in one of the previous slides, we also saw natalizumab. Vedolizumab can be used for both ulcerative colitis and Crohn's disease. This can be used for both ulcerative colitis and Crohn's disease. So in Crohn's disease, basically the treatment is going to be the same as we saw in ulcerative colitis. Gives you the different regimen. Now, even though we see that patients may be on mesalamine, sulfasalazine, there's no actual data to show that they're effective in maintenance. They can be effective in adoption, but there is no evidence that it affected the 5 years of preparations. Yeah, you see it being used in Crohn's disease, but there is no evidence that it affected in maintenance. The use of antibiotics usually will also be in patients who have Crohn's disease. Use of antibiotics will also be efficient for prostate. Mr. Kunimab of Stellara. It's an anti-IL-12/IL-23. The same indication in patients who have failed or intolerant of immune modulator corticosteroid. Patients who cannot use TNF alpha blocker. Now, it's noteworthy that the infusion dose is going to be, the induction dose is going to be intravenous infusion. The induction dose is going to be intravenous infusion. However, the maintenance will be sub-Q. The induction dose is weight-based. The induction dose is weight-based. However, the maintenance is standard, regardless of your weight. It's going to be 90 milligrams. So the maintenance dose is standard for every patient, regardless of your weight. But the induction dose is going to be weight based. Okay, so this brings me back to Netilizumab Tysabri. The reason clinicians have to register in a TORCH program is because of this progressive risk of multifocal leukocyte cellulopathy, which vedolizumab does not seem to have. They put in the same class, but vedolizumab does not seem to have this risk. So primarily, this is the reason why if the clinician wants to prescribe Tysabri, they have to enroll in the TORCH program. So consequently, you don't see this drug being used that much. Instead, vedolizumab is preferred because they don't have to go through the risk of this and also enrolling in this program. Okay, this slide just gives us the adverse effect profile and the monitoring recommendations. So these are some of the reasons why we don't want to give long-term glucocorticoids. And we talked about budesonide, although it's a corticosteroid, it has less systemic bioavailability. More considered a topical agent, so it doesn't have the same systemic effect like systemic corticosteroids. So with the 5-ASA preparations, you see sulfasalazine, parasalazine and oxalazine, they are bonded to the 5-ASA preparation and they need an enzyme clean the bone to release them. So the use of antibiotics may also affect the effectiveness of these medications. So you're going to eradicate the organisms that can cleave the bone. So the organisms that can cleave the bone can be eradicated when you give them antibiotics. So the patient may not respond. This primarily refers to the bonded molecules, which will include sulfosides and valsalvides and valsalvides. These are broken down to release the 5-ASA molecule. And we talked about the immunomodulators being very toxic agents. One thing I need to stress also is that for the biologics, you also need to rule out tuberculosis before you give patients those medications. You have to rule out tuberculosis. So you have to do a screening test. So if the patient happens to, the test happens to be positive, the TB has to be treated first before you give them biologics. TB has to be treated for the pregnant mother. For the immunomodulators, again, we need to know the activity of the tyrosine methyltransferase. We need to know the activity. If the activity is low, you want to avoid the use of this medication because it's going to accumulate. So when we say the activity is low, it means the clearance of the drug is also going to be low. So that will expose the patient to significant toxicity. If the activity is high, then that will require us to adjust or escalate the dose of the medication. It's just a continuation of adverse effect profile. Again, methotrexate is also toxic. As a tumor necrosis starts, some of the patients may develop fusion reaction, so we need to be aware of that. Antihistamine available. Sometimes we also need some corticosteroids. Patient may also need medications like acetaminophen for the temperature that can be associated. So you should be aware that infusing this medication could also result in infusion related. Like I said previously, you have to do a TB screening, so you have to do a tuberculin test. You have to do a tuberculin test. If it's positive, then you have to treat the underlying TB before you expose the patient to this medication.
That's even if it's latent?
Yeah. Even if it's landed here, because this can also increase patient immune response. Now, you also see, we talked about malabsorption in this patient, vitamin deficiency, so they may need some vitamin supplements. And we also talked about potential use of nicotine. In ulcerative colitis, but not in Crohn's disease. Remember, Crohn's disease can be exacerbated in a exposed patient to smoking or nicotine. So, the potential use of nicotine will be in patients who have ulcerative colitis. Now, it is not recommended that you expose this patient to smoking. But if this patient is already smoking, and they undergo smoking cessation, and they have a risk of ulcerative colitis, that's going to show up. So you have to look at the risk and benefit. So definitely you don't want to expose patients to smoking. Okay. Any question? If he has a slide, last slide, any questions? So, if you give a patient some prostaglandin, why would I need
you?
To
give them folic acid? But mine's going to be on the 13th.
If I give a patient sulfosalazine, why do I need to give folic acid?
Well, because it depletes it. It depletes it.
It's the class, right? So how will sulfosalazine and sulfapyridine cause folic deficiency? That's something you should have had in your chemistry class or whatever. Okay, any questions?